Yeah, fine. So today we'll discuss about the group area. So in the group, basically, when we are discussing about the group in SBR, there are four different, they can get four different types of questions in relation to group. So there can be questions related to basic group structure, but then there can be questions related to group cash flow statement. Okay. Apart from that, you can expect the questions with respect to foreign dairy. And you can get the questions from change in group structure. Okay, so these are different types of questions that you can expect from the consolidation area or the group related areas. Okay, so when it comes to basic group structure, the types of questions you can ask about the goodwill calculation. So the basic goodwill calculation. So how will you calculate the goodwill? It is fair value of the consideration transferred plus the fair value of NCA less fair value of net assets, isn't it? So here, when we are considering the fair value of net assets, as per IFRS 3, we need to consider all identifiable assets and liabilities of the subsidiary. Let's say there are internally generated intangibles such as brand name or like an employee or like a customer list that will not be included in the FS of a subsidiary company, individual FS of a subsidiary company. But when at the time of acquisition or at the time of consolidation, if you are able to identify this fair value of that intangible asset, then we can include it as a part of your net asset calculation. Are you getting it? Can you reply in the chat, guys? So we always make sure that whenever you consider the fair value of the net assets of a subsidiary, we need to consider the fair value of each and every identifiable assets and liabilities. The same way, another adjustment that can come up with respect to goodwill calculation will be the considerations that we transfer to the subsidiary company. So what are the different types of consideration that can happen in the acquisition? It can be cash or shares, or apart from that, there are other two types of consideration that normally the parent can offer to the subsidiary that will include, what are they? Can you just reply in the chat? It will include deferred consideration and contingent consideration. So what do you mean by deferred consideration? Let's say you are promising the subsidiary to pay a fixed amount after a specific period of time in future. Then literally you have to calculate the present value of that payment. Are you getting it? Okay. It will be present value of future cash flows. For the future cash consideration. That's what I mean by deferred consideration. Then there is something known as contingent consideration. So what do you mean by contingent consideration? Can you reply in the chat? What do you mean by contingent consideration?
There is a condition that we...
certain conditions, right? If that scenario happens, then we are about to pay an extra amount. So it depends upon certain events in the future. If that event occur, then we'll pay. For example, you may give a target to the subsidiary company. If the subsidiary company is able to reach that target at profit within the next few months, then we are ready to pay an extra amount there. Are you getting it? Okay, so this type of consideration is known as contingent consideration. So if it's a contingent consideration, there is a chance. So we have to consider that chances of making the payment, because it depends upon certain events in the future. So let's say if the chances of meeting that criteria is 30%, then 30% into the fair value of the consideration that we have to pay. Fair value means literally the present value of future consideration. Whatever the cash consideration which you are about to pay, then multiply it with the percentage. So this 30% indicates, okay, this is a chance, this much percentage chance that we may have to pay this amount if that subsidiary is able to meet that criteria. If they are able to meet that profit target, then we are ready to pay this amount. So we literally need to consider that percentage. Are you getting it? So in the basic growth structure, these are the main adjustments you have to learn with respect to the consideration transfer. And even in NCA, we know that when we calculate NCA, either we can calculate using fair value method or we have partial goodwill approach. Isn't it? So in fair value method, we will calculate the NCA at the fair value. But what about the partial goodwill approach? In partial goodwill approach, we'll calculate the fair value of NCA as NCA into the NCA's percentage into fair value of net asset at acquisition. So this is a method that we'll follow there. Are you getting it? Can I reply in the chat, guys? And most importantly, when we calculate the net assets, when we calculate the fair value of the net assets of a subsidiary, we need to quote the standard IFRS 3 business combination. Okay, so whenever there is we are making any adjustments or we are making any kind of advice with respect to the treatment of goodwill calculation, you need to quote the standard IFRS 3 business combination, because goodwill is calculated using that particular standard. Okay, so when you're using that particular standard, you have to emphasize the importance of that standard there. So literally, when we calculate the net assets of a subsidiary, you need to consider the fair value of its assets as well as its liabilities. If we are able to identify it separately, then we need to consider the fair value of assets and liabilities. Is it clear, everyone? Can I reply in the chat? Yes. So next one, it's about the group cash flow statement. So we'll just go through the group cash flow statement format. Sorry guys. So can you see the Excel? Can you see the Excel now? So this is the format to follow when you are preparing a group cash flow statement. So we basically, when it's a cash flow, we need to know that we have three separate headings, and especially when it comes to SBI, you are not expected to prepare a whole set of cash flow statement, that is operating, financing, and investing. So these are the three different set of cash flow state activities, different three activities that where we have to prepare the cash flow. But in SBI, you are not supposed to prepare the whole full-fledged cash flow statement. You may be asked to prepare an extract. Let's say, for example, they will ask you to prepare an operating activity cash flow. And there will be marks for the calculation of this operating cash flows. At the same time, you will get the marks for the explanation as well. Explanation means you have to discuss about the treatments. You have to discuss about the treatments, the different adjustments. Are you getting it? Let's say if you are adding back the depreciation, or if you are adding back the service cost, and you have to explain the reason by which why we are adding it back, or why it's getting added back to the operating activity. Are you getting it? Yes. So when we prepare the operating cash flow, so operating cash flow will start off with PBT, that is profit from the profit for the year for the company. So the group profit before tax. With respect to that, we'll make these adjustments. What are the adjustments we'll make? We'll make the adjustment for the non-operating items. First one, finance cost. Finance cost is an interest expense, right? It's not related to operating activity. So we'll add it back. So literally, when we calculate the operating cash flow, whatever the finance cost which is getting deducted from your P&L, you have to add it back. Are you getting it? Next one, if there is investment income, such as non-operating income, any dividend income received, or let's say if there is a dividend received from associate, such item needs to be, or like a share of profit of associate, this item needs to be deducted, because these are not related to operating activity, as well as these are not cash flows. These are expense or income. These are not cash flows. Are you getting it? Can I reply in the chat, guys? Then we have to make the adjustment for the non-cash items. So it will include first one, it will include less profit or add loss on disposal. So if there is profit on disposal, we would have added it to the P&L statement. We have added it as an income to the P&L statement. But is it a real cash flow? No. So how will you treat it? We'll reverse that treatment by deducting it from our operating activity. In the same way, if there is loss, we would have charged it as an expense. So now we have to add it back. Then if there is depreciation, amortization, or impairment. So these items, the depreciation, amortization, or impairment, this kind of non-cash expenses should be added back. Then add increase in provision. We have to add the increase in provision, because the increase in provision would have increased your charge. That would have increased your charge there. So we have to adjust it. So how will you adjust it? That increase in expense will reduce your profit in the P&L statement. So now we have to add it back. Are you getting it? Then the service cost. We know that yesterday we have discussed about IAS 19, the service cost. So service cost is an amount that we would have charged to P&L, right? So here we need to reverse it. So how will you reverse it? We'll add it back. Instead, we will deduct the contribution that we have paid into the scheme. The contribution made into the scheme will get deducted, because it's an amount that we contribute to our employees. So as per IAS 19, the contribution which we made into the scheme will get deducted. Are you getting it, guys? Next one, add expense. As per IFRS 2, if there is any share-based treatments, we know that whether it is cash-based share-based payment or whether it is equity settled share-based payment, we know that there is an expense that we charge. There is expense, the debit expense. Always there is an debit. Debit will go to the expense account or the P&L account, right? So that amount should get added back. That amount should get added back. So that's an addition we have shown here. So the expense that we charge to P&L with respect to the share-based payment schemes should be added back. Less decrease in provision. If there is a decrease in provision, we know that it's reduced our expense. It actually reduced our expense, right? Decrease in provision actually reduced our expense. So it would have overstated, it would have increased our profit. So literally we have to deduct it. That decrease in provision needs to be deducted. Is it clear, everyone? Now we have to adjust for the change in the working capital. Inventory or payables, we have to adjust for it. The reason being, the working capital is an amount that we invest for our operation, the day-to-day operation activities of a company. So any movements in the working capital is also getting adjusted in your operating activity. So the reason I am explaining each and every line items, because you have to explain the reason by which, why it's getting adjusted as a part of operating activity. At the same time, what's the reason for adding it back or deducting it? This is what ultimately you have to explain in your SBR paper. Rather than preparing a cash flow statement, you should be able to explain the reason by which we are making those adjustments. Are you getting it? Yes. So if there is an increase in receivable or an increase in inventory, because these are current assets. So if there is an increase in the current assets, the assets will increase, but literally there will be an outflow of cash. So these are considered to be cash outflow. And if there is decrease in receivables or decrease in inventory, then it's like an inflow. At the same time, if there is an increase in payable, then it's a out inflow, because if the payable increases, I've taken more debt. That's why my payable have increased. So there is an inflow, and decrease in payable, again, it's an outflow. And finally, you will get the cash flow from operation. And from this figure, we will deduct interest paid and tax paid. Then you will get, ultimately, you will get a net cash flow from operation. Are you getting it? Next one, we'll discuss about cash flow from investing activity. So the cash flow from investing activity will include any type of purchases that we have made, especially when it comes to a group cash flow. The purchase may include the investment in associate or the investment that you have made for acquiring a subsidiary. Everything will get included in your investing activity. Okay. And the dividend received from associate, as well as any kind of other interest received, everything will be shown as a part of your investing activity. And the sale proceeds from the disposal of an asset, as well as the sale proceeds from the disposal of an associate or subsidiary, everything will come as a part of your investing activity here. So the investing activity is not that much difficult. The more explanations or more adjustments are required in your operating activity. So make sure that you prepare well for that operating activity adjustments. I hope it's clear. Do you have any doubts with regards to any adjustments in the operating activity?
The two interest rates are same.
Sorry?
The interest paid, we take in twice.
The reason being, in the top, we are actually adjusted for the finance cost. It's an expense. It's a non-cash expense. Literally, it's a kind of non-cash expense. So we have added it back because it's an expense. And what we have deducted, the interest paid. So that's a real cash flow. And we are deducting it from the cash flow from operation because we are trying to show it to the external parties that the company have made enough cash flow from their operations to make this interest payments. So that's why we are following that order. Are you getting it?
Okay.
Any other doubts? Any other doubt, guys? Okay, cool. So now it's about, we have discussed the financing activity, and next one it is investing activity. Now it's about the financing activity. So in financing activity, we have to discuss about the proceeds we have got from the issue of shares, the proceeds that we have got from the issue of loan note or debentures, less any cash repayments or loan or debenture, and the redemption of shares, then lease liability repayments, the dividend paid by the parent, less dividend paid to NCA. So whatever which we paid to redeem the shares or to redeem the loan note, everything will become an outflow. If you have raised the fund through any kind of share issues or loan note issues, that will be an inflow in the financing activity. And when this comes to dividend payment, since it's a group, we have to consider the dividend which is paid to the external party by the parent, as well as the dividend paid to NCA by the subsidiary. But we won't consider the dividend paid by subsidiary to the parent because it's an intra-group transaction, so it will not come as a part of your group cash flow statement. Is it clear, everyone? Can reply in the chat. So this is what the format for group cash flow statement. So literally you should know the explanation for each and every item. Yeah, the dividend received from associate will be shown in investing activity. The dividend received from associate will be shown in investing activity. But the share of profit of associate that we literally show in the SOPL item, that will get deducted in the operating activity because that's an investing income and it's not a cash flow. It's just a portion of the profit that we release as per equity method. So we have to deduct it in the operating activity, and whatever the cash dividend received in hand from the associate, that portion we will show it as a part of your investing activity. Can I reply in the chat, guys? When it comes to the investment associate, the dividend that we receive from the associate will get deducted. Yeah, the profit, so the share of profit from associate will get added. And the dividend received from associate will get deducted. Okay. So next one. So that's it for the group cash flow statement. Next one is about the foreign subsidiary. So when this comes to foreign subsidiary in the group scenario, we'll do a question. So in the group scenario, when it comes to a foreign subsidiary, First of all, we need to identify the functional currency. The important bit is we need to identify a functional currency. So when it comes to a foreign subsidiary, the functional currency of a foreign subsidiary can be taken as the currency of your parent company itself. But considering the fact that the parent company should have a autonomy over subsidiary. The autonomy doesn't mean the control, the normal control. Let's say if the subsidiary is depending on the parent on in terms of sales, like major amount of transactions are happening between the subsidiary and parent, or the parent is providing some source of finance for the subsidiary. So these are the items that will create a autonomy of a subsidiary. In that situation, the functional currency of a foreign subsidiary will be same as of its parent. Whatever the parent's functional currency, then even the subsidiary's functional currency also will be the same. Is it clear? Can you reply in the chat? Yes. Then once we identify the functional currency, next one, we need to identify the rates that we have to use to convert this foreign subsidiary items in your home currency, because we need to convert the foreign subsidiary items into home currency to prepare the consolidated statement, right? Because we can't add it together. If the assets in one company is in dollars and assets in the subsidiary company is in dinars, then I can't consolidate it. So I have to convert this dinars into dollars. So when I'm making this conversion, what are the rates I can use? So with respect to SOFP, the items in the SOFP will use the closing rate. The closing rate means rate as per your reporting date. And with respect to SOPL, such as the depreciation, the profit, the impairment, the post-acquisition movement, these are the items that will affect SOPL. For that, we will use the average rate. We'll be using the average rate. So if the average rate is not there, then we'll use the closing rate itself. So whenever we focus on this functional currency identification, we'll do it as per IAS 21. So as I've already mentioned, whenever we are identifying the functional currency of a subsidiary, we have to consider the fact that whether the subsidiary is having same currency, having an autonomy over, if there is an autonomy by the parent company over subsidiary. If that situation does not meet, if that criteria does not meet, then we have to literally follow the rules mentioned in IAS 21 to identify the functional currency of a subsidiary company. So what are the rules? We have got two different factors to be considered when we are determining the functional currency. What are they? The first one being the primary factors. The primary factors means the currency that influences the sales price, the currency of that influence, the country's currencies whose competitive forces that will influence the sales price, or the currency in which we actually incur the cost of labor, material, and all these stuffs. So these are the primary factors. If the primary factors does not give a conclusion, then we'll move on to the secondary factors. That is the currency in which actually will raise the financing cash flow, or the currency from which we'll actually receive the cash receipts from your operating activity. So these are the secondary factors. So we'll consider both primary factors and secondary factors to arrive at a conclusion that which one needs to be considered as your functional currency. Is it clear, everyone? So it's always important to mention these principles in your answer. Whenever you are asked to, whenever you get a question to discuss that, how will you calculate the functional currency there, literally you have to mention these standards as well, the principles of the standards. Okay, so that's it. And apart from that, whenever you do the conversion of any items which relates to SOPL, make sure that you will do conversion at the closing rate. And if it's an item related to SOPL, we'll use the average rate. And any kind of the exchange rate movements, the translation gain or loss, it will get accounted as a part of your OCA. So any translation gain or loss with respect to this SOFP item or SOPL item will be reported in OCA and will be reclassified to P&L. On disposal, will be reclassified to P&L on disposal. Is it clear, everyone? Yeah, it will be recorded in OCA asked, or in SOFP, it will be shown under translation reserves. But whatever the amount that we show in translation reserves will get ultimately reclassified to P&L on disposal. Are you getting it? Is it clear, Chris and O? Yeah, only the parent part. We'll reclassify only the parent portion on the time. Then finally, we have change in group structure. So when it comes to change in group structure, we have to discuss about another four different situation. First one, I will discuss about the step acquisition. When there is step acquisition, the first one being no control to control. That is, earlier before the acquisition, we were, let's say, assume we are an associate, and by acquiring more share, now we become a subsidiary. So it's like a no control to control movement. In that scenario, we have to calculate the goodwill. We need to calculate the goodwill. So how will you calculate the goodwill here? It is consideration. This consideration transferred plus the fair value of existing shares, because we already have a share in the same company, right? We were an associate, less the fair value of net assets. Are you getting it, guys? Can you reply in the chat? And let's say if there is an NCA, then we have to include the fair value of NCA as well. If you are not acquiring it, if it is not a 100% acquisition, then we have to include the NCA as well. So in normal situation, we'll assume that it will be including, there will be NCA as well. So a general formula to calculate the goodwill when there is a no control to control situation. No control to control means earlier used to have a 30% or a 40% of shares in a company. Now we are acquiring more shares in the same company. So we have to calculate the goodwill there, because it is a movement from no control to control. So it will be fair value of the consideration transferred plus fair value of existing shares plus fair value of NCA less fair value of net assets. Is it clear, everyone? Okay, fine. And finally, you will get the, so as a result, finally, you will get the goodwill. The goodwill on disposal. Sorry, goodwill on acquisition. The next one will be, in the step acquisition, the next scenario we have to discuss is control to control situation. The next scenario will be control to control situation. So if there is a control to control situation, then how will you account for it? Control to control means you already got a control 80%. Now you'll acquire more shares. Let's say you get 90% of shares. So in the control to control situation, do you need to calculate a goodwill? No. There we know that we are acquiring more shares so that the NCA's percentage will go down. So it will be debit NCA. The NCA value will go down, and credit cash. We have to pay cash because we are acquiring more shares. And since it's just a movement happening within the equity, the gain or loss will be recorded as a part of your other components of equity. So this is how we should account for the movement in control to control situation. So if it's a control to control scenario, this is how we should account for it. Is it clear, everyone? Can I reply in the chat? Yes. Next one, the step disposal. So when it comes to step disposal, first of all, we'll discuss about control to control. Control to control means, yeah, now it became 50%. So this is what is left. So in that scenario, if there is control to control situation, then again, we know that as a result of the disposal, the NCA has increased. So debit NCA, credit, sorry, it is in NCA is increasing, right? So it will be debit cash, we got cash as a part of the disposal, and the NCA is increasing, so credit NCA, and any balance figure will go to other components of equity. And any kind of balancing figure, any balance figure will go to other components of equity. Are you getting it, guys? Is it clear? So if it's a step disposal and if it's a situation where we are having 80% of shares in a subsidiary and we are disposing at 20% of the shares, now what is left is 60%. So it's less like a movement from control to control situation. So literally we'll account it as a debit cash and debit or credit OCE, other components of equity, and credit will go to NCI. Is it clear, everyone? Yeah. So how to calculate the NCA's increase? So here we know that the NCA have increased by 20%. So anyway, we cannot calculate it as NCA, like let's say if the NCA's figure before the disposal was 20 million, we cannot take the 20% of the 20 million because NCA is not only holding 20%. Now they have got an additional 20% of the subsidiary's net assets, right? So that increase will be, so the net assets of the subsidiary at disposal plus the goodwill of the subsidiary so we'll take this value and we have to take the total value of this goodwill and the net assets of subsidiary at disposal, then take the 20% of this amount. So that's how we'll calculate that increase in NCA. Is it clear, Chris? Can I reply in the chat? No. That's not the appropriate way because we haven't calculated the 80%, right? So we haven't calculated the 80%. They were not having any figures where we showing just showing the 80%. So we always show the equity as 100%. Yeah. So next one, control to no control. So control to no control means, let's say you are having 80% and you dispose a 50%, and now what is left is 30%. So this is control to no control. So when there's a control to no control situation, you have to calculate the profit or loss on disposal. So how will you calculate the profit or loss on disposal? So the sale proceeds plus the fair value of remaining investment That is the 20% is left. From that, we'll deduct the net interest in subsidiary. The net interest in subsidiary. So we know that the subsidiary will include the net assets at disposal. Then the subsidiary will have the goodwill at disposal. So it will include net asset at disposal. Good. We need to calculate the net interest in subsidiary. So whatever the fair value of NCA at disposal, that portion needs to be deducted. Okay. Then if you net off these three figures, you will get a figure. That figure represents the net interest in subsidiary. So we need to compare this with this sale proceeds and the fair value of remaining investment. To get the profit or loss on. So whenever we do the profit or loss on disposal, if it's a foreign subsidiary, just remain the fact that we need to add whatever the portion which is left in the translation reserve with respect to the gain or loss on the foreign transactions into parent's portion. That will get added with the profit or loss on disposal. To calculate the final profit. Is it clear, everyone? Can you reply in the chat, guys? Okay, so these are the main components that you have to learn with respect to the group. The basic group structure part, then no control to control situation, the change in group structure area, the foreign subsidiary part, we have discussed about it, and the group cash flow statement, and finally the change in group structure area. Is it clear, everyone? Okay, guys, so that's it for the day. The discussion of the past paper. So that's the end there for the revision section. So the discussion of all past papers, the current issues, then the interpretation area. Okay, so this will be uploaded in my YouTube channel. You can just go through it. So each and every, mostly the most important past papers, such as March, June, December, September, December questions, group, both the group question as well as the other standards. I have recordings for it. I will be uploading in the YouTube channel. So once we cover all these topics, then later on you can just go through it. Okay, because I don't have enough time to go through each and every question from the past paper. So that's why we are doing the same. So the knowledge area, which is really important for the paper, we have tried to cover in the live section itself. So in the recordings, I will be just giving the different questions, past paper questions will be shared as recordings, and that will be available in the YouTube channel. Most probably we'll upload it by the end of the day. So we are waiting for the sections to get over. So we already have recordings for it. So we'll uploading it by the end of the day itself. Yeah, if there is an intra-group sale, if there is an inventory if loss, yes, even that needs to be netted off. Because that will understate the inventory value and you can literally understate your profit as well. So we have to, whenever there is an intra-group transaction, we need to remove its effects, whether it's a loss or a gain. Yeah. If you have any other doubts or specifically to any of these standards, you can ask me. So the journal entry for PURP and associate depends upon who is seller. Who is the seller? If let's say if associate is the seller, in that scenario, it will be debit the cost of sales of associate, and the credit will go to group inventory because the inventory is left with us itself. Okay. But let's say if the parent is a seller to associate, in that scenario, the debit retained earnings of the parent and credit will go to investment in associate because the inventory is with the associate there. Inventory is not held in our group. So we cannot credit the group inventory. So there the credit will go to investment in associate column. Is it clear, Rachel? So is there any other doubts you have specifically to group or any other standards? Okay, so this will be a last day of your revision class, and there will be another day left that will consider as a final wrap up. So I will not be taking it right now. So you guys can go the next 2 weeks. You can just not hardly 2 weeks is there, right? So maybe the last Saturday. Like I hope the exam will be on SBR paper is on September 11th, right? It's on September 11th. So hardly now we have got around exactly around 18 days. Okay, so let's say on August 4th, we'll have a final wrap up section so that in meantime, in this 2 weeks, we can just go through here, go through, focus on the whatever we have discussed in the live sections in the recording, in the revision section. You can just go through the standards and practice the questions, and I will be sharing the recordings as well. And later on, if you have any doubts, we'll clear it in this final wrap up. So that will be on Saturday. So most probably on August 4th. Okay. And more details regarding the test section will get uploaded in our group itself. Why in revaluation? Which one, da Babu? I haven't got your full question. Why in revaluation gain goes to OCA and loss go to PCA? So the gain goes to OCA. It's just the fact that it's not a gain. Actually, we have raised through our operating activity. Okay, and literally, if you are showing such gains in your SOPL, it can distort the performance of our company. Because it is completely volatile, right? This sometimes it will be a gain or sometimes it will be a loss. So if you are reporting this gain directly in SOPL, in a particular year, the gain will be higher. So the profit will be higher. And the next year, if the gain is not there, then it can distort the performance of the company. And moreover, it's not a gain that we get from the main operating activity. Isn't it? Can I reply in the chat? So, but if it's a loss, as per Prudence concept, it is mentioned that whenever it's a loss and whenever you anticipate a loss, that loss needs to be recognized immediately in the P&L. So that's the reason. If there is a loss, after charging it to any revaluation surplus, which is balance, which is left in the OCA, we'll charge the remaining amount to P&L as an expense. Yeah. Any other doubts? Okay, so again, you have got a good amount of time. So almost 18 days is worth enough. If you're properly planning it again, you can easily revise the topics and score good marks. And most probably, if you have any doubts in between, I have given my number. You can get in touch. So even though you can't expect a quick reply, but anyway, I will make sure that I will reply it. Give the replies. Okay. So that's it, guys. Just focus on these areas and the recordings of this current issues, the interpretation part, as well as the different question from the past papers will be uploading in my YouTube channel. You can just go through it. Okay, guys. So that's it for today.